Good morning. Welcome to St. John Hill Church. My name is Dave Bitler. I'm the pastor here. If you're visiting with us this morning, I wish you a special welcome. Thank you for worshiping with us today. A few announcements before we begin. Some of you, if you've worked in certain fields, you know that every year you get a performance review, right? And in those performance reviews, they always, tell you, here's your strengths. And then at the very end, they say, and here's an opportunity for growth, right? We have those here, right? We have a lot of things that we do really well. But there are also opportunities for us to grow and to do things better. One of the things that we have done really well is we do really well on getting resources coming in to the church. What we haven't done as well as we could is getting those resources moving out. And so our missions committee has been largely shouldered by Mark and Connie Heil for the past couple of years. And we need to get them some help. In the narthex on the bulletin board, I've got a sign-up sheet. The missions committee really, focuses on the issue of need, helping us to identify needs, both locally and internationally, and then helping to administer resources that we have that can help meet those needs. And there's a lot of ways that you can help with that, but if that is something that is on your heart, we would love to have you help us improve in that area. So if you sign up there, we'll get in contact with you as to when meetings will happen, but we really need to kind of centralize our focus on that. Another thing, also in the narthex, are some sheets. If you would like to become a member here at Hill Church, we will be receiving new members on Palm Sunday, which is not that far away. It will be March the 24th this year. We would love to have you join us in membership. That way you can vote and hold office if that's something that you would like. The sheets are out there with the questions that we ask and expect all members to be able to answer yes to. Take one of those, read it over. If you have any questions, contact me directly and we'll talk. But if you can answer yes to all those questions, just fill it out and hand it back to me whenever you can. Preferably by or before March the 17th, the week before, so that we can know how many we'll have coming in. We've already got a number who have expressed interest in that and would love to have you join us. Rick has an announcement for us that comes with a little bit of music, too. So.
Signature sound. They're obviously a gospel quartet. They've performed nationally and internationally over the last 20, 30 years with a Gator band. And, Linda and I have always been very fond of them. And so one day last fall, she said, why don't we see if we can get them to come and give us a concert? So she called them and they said, they'd be up for it. And so we went and listened to them last fall in Lancaster. And they are willing to come to our farm 3 months from today. April 21st, Sunday afternoon or Sunday evening. And so just wanted to share that with you. We're in the final stages of finalizing the contract for it. But we also are going to need to raise money for them. They cost $10,000, and plus all the other stuff to put it on, stage, chairs, lights, sound system, all that kind of stuff. But so what we're going to do is they're going to be in Bath, New York on the 19th and 20th, and they'll just swing through here on their way back to their home base in Ohio, Indiana. So they would be here on Sunday afternoon or evening and have to finalize the time. And what we would do is we would just have a free will offering at the event to help defray the cost of the event. Before that, we're soliciting sponsors to help with it. And so far we have four groups. Holy Valley Feed, the folks who built our riding arena, King Construction out of Lancaster, Phil Church has raised their hand to donate money, and Linda and I are each going to, we're all going to give some money. So if you know any businesses or you personally would like to be a sponsor, get a hold of me and we'll be happy to, you know, let you know what the details are. But the hope is that through the goodwill offering at the event, we would be able to return most, if not all, of the sponsorship money. But if not, it'll just be a donation to help people come and enjoy what we hope will be a big community event where not just Hill Church, but many people from the Holy Valley and Boyertown and Reading and Allentown can come and enjoy this group on a Sunday afternoon or Sunday evening. You're going to have to get a ticket for it, and we'll give you information about that later. And you'll go on their website, and you can go on their website online, Ernie Haas and Signature Sound. If we had a bulletin, you'd see it in there. You'll see it next week. But you'll have to print out a ticket. It won't cost you anything, but you just have to have a ticket to come to the event. In our arena, we think we can hold between 500 and 700 people, so it could be a big group, and we're hoping it's a big group. So it's not just us, but many other people. So put it on your calendar, 42124, 42124, 3 months from today. Ernie Haas and Signature Sound.
Looking forward to that. Also looking forward to, right around that same time, we'll be taking a trip to see Daniel at Sight and Sound. They're still sign up, again, on the bulletin board in the narthex, and the money is due to Clara. Of course, Clara's back there.
Can I just say a couple
things? Sure. So plenty of seats still available. The day of the performance, we'll be leaving at 8:45. Eat a big breakfast before you come. Maybe put a snack in your pocket, because then lunch will be sometime around 2 for that. Are there any other announcements before we begin this morning? All right. Let's take a few moments then as we prepare our hearts for worship and hear the prelude.
Thank you.
Would you stand for our call to worship, which comes from Psalm 62, verses 5 through 12. For God alone, O my soul, wait in silence, for my hope is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rests my salvation and my glory. My mighty rock, my refuge is God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. For though those of low estate are but a breath, those of high estate are a delusion. In the balance they go up, they are together lighter than a breath. Put no trust in extortion. Set no vain hopes on robbery. If riches increase, set not your heart on them. Once God has spoken, twice have I heard this, that power belongs to God, and that to you, O Lord, belongs steadfast love. For you will render to a man according to his work. Would you join me as we sing our opening hymn? It's number 67 in your brown hymnal. The words will also be on the wall behind me, For the Beauty of the Earth. Almighty God, by grace alone you call us and accept us in your service. Strengthen us by your Spirit and make us worthy of your call. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. So we come to our Heidelberg Catechism questions for this Lord's Day. Last week we entered into the section that deals with mankind's state of sin and misery prior to our deliverance, and that we can in no way in and of ourselves love God as we should. And I'll ask you to forgive me because my allergies decided to act up when the snow came this week. So question 6, again, reads, did God then create man so wicked and perverse? Let's answer together.
No. On the contrary, God created man good and in his image, that is, in true righteousness and holiness, so that he might readily know God, his creator, heartily love him, and live with him in eternal blessedness, and praise and glorify him.
And again, if you look at the numbers there, they relate to where those answers are found in the scriptures. I think there are full copies in the narthex if you do not have one and would like to take one home for your own study. Question 7 then says, from where then did man's depraved nature come? Let's answer together.
From the fall and disobedience of our first parents, Adam and Eve, in paradise. For there our nature became so corrupt that we are all conceived and born in sin.
Question 8 asks, but are we so corrupt that we are totally unable to do any good and inclined to all evil? Let's answer together.
Yes, unless we are regenerated by the Spirit of God.
And one of the ways we receive that regeneration is in confession of our sin to the Lord. And so, since we don't have bulletins today, you'll need to follow on the wall behind me. We apologize for not having bulletins. Our copier decided to have some drum issues, and with the weather being what it was late in the week, the repairman could not get here by this morning. So everything will be up on the screen. But we'll pray the prayer of confession together in unison. Following that time, we'll take a few moments in silent confession to confess our own personal sins to the Lord. I'll then close us in prayer and offer us some words of assurance. Let us pray together.
Merciful Lord, we confess that with us there is an abundance of sin, but in you there is fullness of righteousness and abundance of mercy. We are spiritually poor, but you are rich, and in Jesus Christ came to be merciful to the poor. Strengthen our faith and trust in you. We are empty vessels that need to be filled. Fill us. We are weak in faith. Strengthen us. We are cold in love. Warm us. And make our hearts fervent for you, that our love may go out to one another and to our neighbors, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let's take a few moments in silent confession this morning. Loving God, through your Son, you have called us to repent of our sin, to believe the good news, and to celebrate the coming of your kingdom. Like Christ's first apostles, may we hear his call to discipleship and, forsaking old ways, proclaim the gospel of new life to a broken world. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Hear these words of assurance from 1 Corinthians 6. And such were some of you. Paul had just listed a long list of sinful behaviors. And he says, such were some of you, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. Let's sing together the doxology. Is the third Sunday of the month, which means it is we'll be taking up our joyful noise offering. And so I will ask any of our children who would like to come and help us to come up and grab a bin. They'll be coming around looking for just some spare change, which goes to help our Christian Education Committee with its work during the year. We'll give them a few minutes of head start, and then we'll have our ushers come in as we take up our morning tithes and offerings. stand and return thanks. God, thank you for upholding our lives. As we give our gifts and tithes to you, we are reminded of your great gift to us. We give you praise and honor for giving us the indescribable gift of your Son, Jesus. It is two wonderful words that Jesus laid down his life so we could be translated from death to life. We are so blessed that Jesus redeemed us from the curse and set us free for you and with you for eternity. Amen. Please remain standing as we continue to sing.
We
If you have your Bibles, would you turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4? We'll be reading verses 17 through 24 this morning. And again, to keep this in its context, the first three chapters that Paul writes to the church at Ephesus, he's writing them and telling them what is true. True things about God and his relationship to us. Expounding, exploding on his great love for us. And he spends the first half of this letter just driving home again and again, this is who God is. This is who we are. This is what he has done for us. And then the rest of the letter, he then goes on to expound, and this is how you live as the church. This is what it means. This is the right response for such wonderful love that is poured out on us. Indeed, that's how we see the Heidelberg Catechism is set out. It begins talking about our condition of sin and misery. Then it talks about our deliverance through Jesus Christ. But the bulk of the questions that you'll see as we move throughout the year are talking about how do we live in thankfulness for that wonderful deliverance. Paul's just been talking about how we are to live in love and unity with each other in Christ. And we pick up in verse 17. Let's hear the word of God to us this morning. Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, due to the hardness of heart. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. But that is not the way you learned Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him, as the truth is in Jesus, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. May God add his blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. Let's take a moment to pray. Almighty God, Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, as we come this morning to consider your word to us, would we not see it as just the words of man, but the word of God spoken in love to us? Father, would your Spirit help us to receive your word this morning, that we would apply it to our hearts, and so to live according to your word. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I was scrolling through some internet videos, which is not a good habit to get into, but every once in a while, just for some mindless distraction. And I came across one, and I wish I would have saved it somehow. I could go back and find it, because it really caught my attention. And the more I thought about it, the more it really disturbed me. Perhaps you've seen videos like this where they have, 10 random people in a room, and I think all of them were under the age of 30. And someone will make a statement, and then the room will divide between those who agree and those who disagree. And the statement that they made was this: Satan is evil. Of the 10 people standing there, one agreed. I out of 10 people, one agreed. Under the age of 30. Paul says, now this I say and testify in the Lord. He wants the Ephesian church to know, he said, if you get nothing else, I'm saying this as if God had said it directly to me, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. See, as the church, we understand when we belong to Christ, he does something to our minds. He renews them. He regenerates them. This is what, you know, when Jesus was talking with Nicodemus in John chapter 3, he says, don't you know you have to be born again? Not of water, but of the Spirit. Be born, and that Spirit is what renews our mind to allow us to get out of that futility thinking that only centers and focuses on ourselves and looks to what God has created for us. Some of the answers in that video of why people answered no to the question, is Satan evil? They said, well, we only got one perspective on the story. Right? He was just trying to help, right? You know, to give them wisdom. I mean, because after all, God just left them naked in the garden. We didn't hear his side of the story. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, due to their hardness of heart. So this is why, you know, Paul would say, when I preach Christ, it is as foolishness to the world. And it is, if someone's heart has not been open to hear the gospel, they're not going to hear it. Jesus actually said that part of the reason that he spoke in parables, you know, and parables are just stories that come alongside of a teaching. The reason that he spoke in parables was actually for a judgment for those who would not hear him. He says, if you have ears to hear, you will hear what I mean. But I'm going to put it out there so plainly that if your heart is darkened and you have become callous to the things of God, it will be right in front of you, but you won't see it. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. We might read this and think, well, he's talking about what's going on in the world today. Well, he was writing this 2,000 years ago. The nature of sin doesn't change. But he says, but that is not the way you learned Christ. You know, he said, you know, in the previous section, he says that, you know, we are to be called to be one body in Christ. We are to embody the family name. That's what the name Christian means. It means I am taking the name of Christ for myself. And the way that we live that out is the world should see in us the family resemblance, the family character. When I was in high school, I think between the end of my junior year of high school, somebody, I never found out who, nominated me to go to a summer leadership conference at Houghton College. It's a small little Christian college in the southern tier of New York. And it was only for a weekend, right? It was like Friday, Saturday kind of thing. Maybe Sunday morning, our parents came and picked us up. And throughout the weekend, I got through the whole weekend. I never made it over. I wanted to go to the bookstore to get just a souvenir, right? So as our parents were coming to pick us up, I was in the bookstore, you know, looking for, and I don't even remember what I bought. But here's what I remember. I remember coming back into the gathering room, and there stand my mother and my father talking to one of the other young people who was at the conference. And I remember hearing her say, she pointed to my father and she said, "You must be David's dad." Now, how would she know that? Well, it's pretty simple, right? I sound and act a lot like my father. In fact, I've said many times, genetics is a hard thing to overcome. You know, Rose will tell you, the first time she met my dad, we were having dinner at a restaurant, and my dad and my mom were sitting here, I'm sitting here, and Rose is sitting here. My dad's sitting directly across from me. And she's sitting watching the two of us talk to each other, and she's like, they're the same person, right? Their mannerisms are the same, their voice is the same, just, you know, their cadence of speech is the same, so that if you met one of us, you knew something about the other. That's how we should be as members of the family of God. See, that didn't happen by accident. Why was that the case that I tend to sound and talk and act a lot like my dad? Because we spent time together. I listened to him. I mean, he read me bedtime stories every night as a kid. My dad taught social studies in my high school for 30 years. So I'm not lying when I say my bedtime stories came from the 16-volume Encyclopedia of U.S. History. I had my dad for American history in high school. People wondered why I could pass that class and sleep through it. Sorry, I've been hearing this for a long time. I know what the content is, right? People would call on the phone when I was a kid. I'm like 8, 9, 10 years old. Right? My dad also sold real estate, so he was always doing business with somebody. People would call on the phone, "Hello?" Right? "Oh, Harold, here's what's going on." And they would just start talking. And I was taught that on the phone, you be polite, you don't interrupt people. So 5 minutes later, I have to say, "Well, that's all very interesting, but my dad's not here, and I don't know that I can remember all of that to take it down as a message. Would you like me to have him call you back later?" Right? "This isn't Harold?" "No, this is David." "You sound just like your dad." This is what Paul is telling us. We are brought out of a family and adopted into a new one. And we are supposed to be spending so much time with our dad that when people meet us, they go like, "Oh, so I know something about your dad." Right? So that's what the family sounds like. That's how I can identify that you are part of that. If we are claimed to be Christians and we live exactly the same way as the world does, people are going like, "It looks more like you belong to our family than to another one." Because he says, that's not how you learned Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him as the truth in Jesus, right? To do what? To put off your old self. You were part of a worldly family, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires. So not only you knew that you belonged to that family by the way that you behaved in ways that were self-serving and not God-serving, corrupt through deceitful desires, but instead to be renewed, there's that word regenerated, in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. Well, how do we know what righteousness and holiness is? Well, it's here. Jesus was the only truly righteous and holy person to ever walk the face of the earth, and we need to know who he is because we bear his name. And we need to be bearing that family resemblance both in our actions and in our speech. So when people hear us talk, they're hearing the family cadence. They're hearing the family gestures. They're hearing the family words. That means that I belong to the family of Christ. And when we behave and talk in a way that betrays that, that makes us look like we are part of our old family, we're not showing forth who we really are. And this is why Paul will go to great lengths to say, we have to put off the old clothes. We have to put off the old self and intentionally put on the new, right? Both of those things have to happen, and they don't happen by accident, right? They have to be intentional things. Because nobody would go out and buy a new set of clothes just to try to put them on over top of what they were already wearing. Right? Eventually, that gets a little uncomfortable, right? And the clothes don't fit right. So you have to take off the old, put them away, burn them. That's not me. And that's why the first three chapters of Ephesians are so important, because Paul's saying, here is who you are. He says, you have been blessed with in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. You have been chosen before the foundation of the world to be adopted as sons. You've been chosen to be part of a new family according to the purpose of his will. In him we've obtained an inheritance, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. Paul says, remember who you were. Remember that you were dead in your trespasses and sins. So that when we read this, when he says, so now I say this to you and testify in the Lord that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds, darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that's in them due to their hardness of heart. That gives us no right to walk out and say, you stupid, ignorant people. Because Paul already told us, that was you. So there's no room for pride in the Christian life. There's room for our hearts going out to those who are lost to say, come join the real family. It's better on this side of the fence. Let me show you what real life is like. Life that doesn't lead to self-service, but brings us into the community of God. That's our calling. That's being who God has chosen and elected us to be part of the family, to display and act and speak as those who are in the family, in true holiness and true righteousness, through the renewing of your minds. And the only way that our minds can be renewed is if we're spending time with God and his word. We're spending time absorbing who Jesus was. Not who we think he is. It's easy to know and to say, you know, the people in that video, they knew something about Satan. They had heard something about the story of the Garden of Eden. But the one man who answered yes to that question, after, you know, everybody had said their piece, he's like, but that's not the way the story goes. See, he knew the story. And we live in a world that is happy in its ignorance. And if we let them, you know, I tell my kids all the time, misery loves company. If somebody is miserable, they're going to want to make you miserable too, so that they can have some company. The world wants company in its misery. We are called to draw them out of that misery into the true joy of what it means to be truly loved by God. That he loved us enough, even before the foundation of the world, he says, that one is mine. Because there was nothing in us that God said, ooh, that's the smart one, I'll take the smart one, and I'll take the pretty one, I'll take, ooh, that one's got a great sense of humor. That wasn't it. It's not in anything that we were. It was all in who he is that he calls us to himself. So that no one can boast. Because that's part of the family trait. Jesus was meek and humble, gentle and lowly. If you haven't read Dane Ortlund's book, there's a couple of copies left out on the back. You want to get it to who the heart of Christ is and who the heart of the Christian should be. It should be one that is gentle and lowly in heart. How much love does it take for Jesus Christ, the Son of God, to come and to allow himself to be brutalized and killed just so that we could be part of his family? That's a deep, deep love. And if you get through Dane Ortlund's book, Gentle and Lowly, he wrote another one called Deeper. Because we can never get to the deep heart of his love for us. And that's the love that we should be absorbing through spending time with him. And it should be the one that comes out when people meet and talk to us and say, what family do you belong to? Because that's the family that I want. That's our calling to true righteousness and holiness. Amen. In response to God's word, would you join with me as we affirm our faith together by reciting the Apostles' Creed? It's found on the wall behind me.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
So we come before the Lord this morning. There are many that we want to lift up in. Well, let's take these and any unspoken requests that we have before the Lord this morning. Almighty God, we thank you for the love and mercy that comes to us through Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you that we can be part of your family. Lord, we thank you for that privilege and honor that you have bestowed upon us. And Lord, would you help us by your Spirit to reflect well the family name that you have given to us through Jesus Christ. Father, in love for our families, Father, we have mentioned several this morning who need a healing touch from you. And Lord, you know that there are many more on our hearts who need the gift of your presence. So Father, would you help us in the ways that we are able to be your hands and feet? Would you guide us and give us the grace to serve in your name? And Father, would you, by your Holy Spirit, work in each one of those lives? And Lord, bring healing to bear according to your will. All of these things we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught his disciples and so us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you stand as we sing our closing hymn? It's number 391 in the Brown Hymnal. Savior, like a shepherd, lead us.
Words will be on the wall.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you now and forever. Amen.